Good afternoon, students. How are you? I hope you all are fine. And just we have seen the lesson from history, emergence of new kingdom in South India. That means later Cholas and later Pandyas. In that we had seen about the later Cholas and its administration, is it no? So the revival of the Chola Empire, already I speak, told you about the Rajaraja I and Rajendra Chola I. So decline of the Chola Empire, I had to tell about the Rajendra Chola's three successors, and moreover they are not capable rulers. So moreover that Adi Rajendra was killed in civil unrest with his death. Moreover the Vijayalaya line of Chola rule come to the end. We had seen about that, and after that we had seen about the administration, is it no? So moreover the central administration was in the hand of a king. Okay, so as the head of the state, the king enjoyed the enormous power. Moreover it was written down in the palm leaf by his officials, and it will be inscribed on the temple wall. Okay, so moreover the kingship were hereditary in nature, and the ruler selected his eldest son of their apparent, and the remaining son will be selected as the Yuvarajas. That means they will be given as a governor post. Okay, so moreover the administrative training and all the provinces will be took over by the governors. Okay ma, so the Chola rule established a well organized system of administrations. Okay, so administrative convenience, it was divided into provinces or mandalams. So each mandalam, it was subdivided into nadu. Within each nadu, there were many kuram, that means group of villages, and the lowest unit was the gramam. Okay, so here the local administration, it was worked through the various bodies such as the urar, shabayar, nagaratar and the Natar. Okay, so in that agriculture, numerous peasant settlements and the countryside, it was looked over by the head bodies. Okay, so they were known as the Ur. Okay, so the Urar means he is the landholders, they are the landholders. Moreover, the Brahmin village, it was functioned in carried out the administrative, financial and moreover the judicial connections, everything. So Nagaratar, it's the administration of settlement of traders. Moreover, I tell that, is it no, not Amai, that Panchayat head. Everything is called it as a Nagaratar. Okay. So the Mason, blacksmith, goldsmith, weaver, potter, everything was fixed in the Nagaram. Okay. So the assemblies in Ur, Shaba, Nagaram and Nadu worked through various committees. So these committees took care of the irrigation, road, temple, garden, collective of revenue and conducting of religious festivals. Okay. So after that we had seen about the Uttaramerur inscriptions. Is it or not? So in that Uttaramerur inscription, we had seen about the election, local elections. So how totally 30 ward in total. 30 wards will be there in the contestants. Their age is known to be have the eligibility of 35 to 70. Okay. And they should be very well versed in the Vedic text or scriptures. They need to have only land and houses. Okay. So these are the procedure for the eligibility for the contestants. Okay. So how the election is taking place means, moreover, the contestant's name will be written in a palm leaf slip and put it into a pot. Okay. So, the eldest of the assembly, they will pull one out from the slip and declare that first one is the head of the villages and other will be considered as the various committee, and they will be decided in this way. Okay. And revenue, we had seen about the Kanikadan, is it no? The revenue of the Chola state came mainly from the land. So these kinds of land tax was known as the Kanikadan. Okay. So carried out the elaborate survey of land in order to fix the government share of the land revenue. Mostly they will pay the taxes through the kind only. Okay. So there were taxes on profession and tolls on trade also. Okay, up to that we had seen and we already seen about the social structure based on the land relations, is it no? So the Chola rulers gifted the tax-free land to the royal officials. Moreover, we had seen in the first lesson itself. Okay. Velan Vagail land, Pallichandam. Okay. So Vellalas, those who are holding the Velan Vagail land, they are called it as the Vellalas. And Vullukudi, they are the subsection of Vellalar. But they had to cultivate the Brahmadeya and Velan Vagail lands. The holders of Velan Vagail land retain the Melvaram, that means the major share in the harvest, good shares. Okay. And the Ullukudi, that means the Keelvaram people, they will get over the lower share. And another type of people is there, that is the Adimai. They are called the slaves or Panikai Makkal, that means laborers. They will occupy the lowest rung of the society. Okay, this is the social structure based on the land relations. After that, we need to see about the irrigation. Okay. So they give main importance to the irrigations. Okay. So Rajendra Chola, he built the long 16 mile long embankment. Achangarai, they will say embankment. Okay. In Gangai Konda Cholapuram, this is the main example for the irrigation facility. Okay. And Vadivaikal. Okay. That means it's a crisscross channel, one of the traditional type of harvesting the rainwater in the Kaveri Delta. Okay. And Vati, it means the drainage channel. And Vaikal, it's the supply channel. The most commonly owned village channel was called as the Ur Vaikal. Okay. The Nadu level Vaikal is referred to the Nadu Vaikal. The stern system was in practice in distributing the water. So now they are in the summer season, moreover the government is opening the channels, is it no? Opening the dam for the irrigation facility. So this system was followed in the ancient time itself. Okay, ma, that is the irrigation. And religious. So moreover, Chola rules were the ancient Saivites. They are the Hindus only. They are the most in deeds of Lord Shiva. Okay. So moreover, they composed the Saiva saints, the Nayanmar and Nambiyandar Nambi, and it codified them. So which came to be known as the Thirumurai. You already studied in Tamil languages, is it no? Thirumurai. Next one, temples. Okay, so they witnessed an extensive construction of temples. Moreover, in the Tanjavur, Gangaikonda Cholapuram and Tarasuram, it's a repository of architecture, is it no? So we had seen over in the tourist place. If you see the both the picture, you can illustrate the same model of the Tanjavur temple and the Gangaikonda Cholapuram temple. Okay. So temples promoted the not only for the idolship, also it promote for the education, devotional form of art. That means, for example, classical dance, music, drama. So these staff in the temples, they included the temple official, dancing, musician, singer, player, and the musical instruments and the priest also. Musical instrument and the priest also. Okay. So moreover, they give main importance for the temple of. Okay, patriotism. And Cholas as patrons of learning. Okay, Cholas was the great patrons of learning. Okay, for example, Rajendra I established a Vedic college at Ennayiram. That means now in Vilupuram district. Okay, so that means there were totally 340 students. They are learning the Veda, grammar and moreover Upanishad. Okay, under the 14 teachers. So this example was later followed by his successor. As a result, two more such colleges have been founded. Okay, at Thiruvananam near present day Puducherry and Thirumukudal in present day Chengalpattu districts. Okay, so the great literary works are Periya Puranam, Kamba Ramayanam belong to this period. Just underline that page number 125. Cholas as patrons of learning, see the last two lines. The great literacy works Periya Puranam and Kamba Ramayanam belong to this period. Okay. And next one, trade. There were flourishing trade during the Chola period. Trade was carried out by the two guild groups, that is the Anjuvanatar and Manigramatar. Okay. So underline that, Anjuvanatar and Manigramatar. So Anju Manatar comprised the Western, Asian, Arab, Jew, Christian and Muslim. So moreover, they are the maritime traders. Maritime traders means they will be make out the trade through the port to some other islands or some other areas. Okay, other countries. So it is said that Manigramatar were the traders engaged in inland trade. Okay, so both groups merged under the banner of Ain Truver and Disai Ayrit Al Nutruver. That means they are functioning, they had guild in Ayyavale, Karnataka. Okay, so these Ain Truver, moreover, they operate the maritime grade covering the Southeast Asian countries, moreover, the overseas trade. Okay, whatever thing means elephant tusk, coral, transparent glass, betel nuts, cardamom, opaque glass, cotton stuff and moreover silk threads, everything were be imported. Okay, and the item exported from here were sandalwood, ebony, condiments, precious gems, pepper, oil, paddy, grains and salt. Did you understand? Okay. So whatever the things I exported, so the item exported from here was sandalwood, ebony, condiment, precious gems, pepper, oil, paddy, grains and salt. Okay, up to this we had seen about the administrative of the later Cholas. Then we are going to see about the later Pandyas. So introduction, Pandyas were one of the three ancient Tamil dynasty from the South India, that ruled the South India. But intermediately, Korkai, that means associated with the pearl fisheries, we will say that Thoothukudi, is it no? Okay. So, they moved to Madurai later. So, as many of the Tamil inscription of Pandyas have been unearthed in Madurai and its surroundings only. So, these Pandya kings, we called it as the Sangam age also. Okay. So, Madurai is a great center of culture. Poet and writers of Tamil languages gathered here and moreover they contributed of the development of Tamil classic also. So, the Pandyas has re-established their strong position in South Tamil Nadu by the end of the 6th century. So, after the eliminating of Kalabra rule only, the Pandya rule has started. Okay. So, moreover, thereafter taking advantage of declination of Chola Empire, the Pandya re-established their authority and they ruled continued in the 16th century AD. Okay. So there is no question, just underline the important thing for the one word. It's enough, no need to confuse it. Okay. And revival of the Pandya kingdom. Okay. So Kadungan is a king. He recovered the Pandyan territory from the Kalabras in the 6th century. Just underlined it. So he was succeeded by the two others also. That is Arikesari Maravarman. He was the first strong Pandya ruler who ascended the throne. Okay. So he was a contemporary of Mahendra Varman I and Narasimha Varman I. Okay. So, inscription, copper plates, everything praise his victory over the counterparts of Chera, Chola, Pandya and Sinhalese. Okay, Sarikesari Maravarman is identified with the Kan Pandian, that means the persecutor of Jains. Okay, so Thirinjana Sammandan, he converted the Arikesari from Jainism to Saivism. Okay, so this is the example. So, after Arikesari, the greatest of the dynasty was Jatila Parantaka Nedunjadayan. He is also called as the Varaguna one. He is the donor of Velvikudi plates. That means, Nedunjadayan expanded the Pandyan territory to include the Tanjavur, Tiruchirappalli, Salem and Coimbatore districts. So, Nedunjadayan's successor, Srimara Sri Vallabha, Varagana too, they were successfully defeated by the Pallava king. Okay, so they could not face the rising of the Chola dynasty under the Parantaka I. So Parantaka I defeated the Pandya king Rajasingha II and who fled the country in 1920. Okay, so here the Pandya ruler was injured and revived by the Kadungan. Okay, this is the revival of the Pandya dynasty. Okay. So, rise of later Pandyas. So, So this Chola viceroyalty became weak in the Pandya country after the death of the Adi Rajendra. We already seen that, is it no? So eventually the Pandya kingdom could emerge the only leading Tamil dynasty in the 13th century. So this Madurai continued to be their capital, and Kayal was their greater port. And Marco Polo, a famous traveler from Venice, he visited the Kayal twice in 1288 and 1293. He tells us that this port town was full of ships from Arabia and China and bustling with the business activities. Moreover, he praised everything. Okay. And Marco Polo hailed the Pandya kingdom that is the richest and most splendid province in this world. He tell about the South India, that means Pandya dynasty. So together with the Ceylon, he added it produced most of the gems and pearls that was founded in this world. Okay, so he traveled, moreover he traveled all over the places, and he recorded the incidents of sati and polygamy practiced by these kings. Okay, so up to this we had seen, we can see here, so okay, so we can finish here. Moreover, take your book, page number 131. See here, what were the items exported during the later Chola period? Page number 126. See the screen. In the first paragraph, I marked the last three lines. The item exported from here were sandalwood, ebony, condiments, precious gem, pepper, oil, paddy, grains, and salt. So just see the first line. The item exported. Just cancel that from here. Okay, just cancel that from here. So the item exported were sandalwood, ebony, condiments, precious gems, pepper oil, paddy, grains, and salt. Okay, just mark this question and study the two questions already I marked. Okay, just read the lesson once. No need to confuse everything. Just underline whatever thing I am saying and study for the one word. It's enough. So this is a very simple lesson. Moreover, the name, everything will be very confused, but it's a very simple lesson. Okay, just study the two questions, and remaining thing we can see over in the next class. Thank you, children. Thank you, Ma.